Education, it is said, is the most powerful weapon which you can use to change the world. As a scholar and academician, Dr. Ehtisham Hasnain's contribution to education and the sciences is immense. As the Vice Chancellor of Jamia Hamdard, he continues on this illustrious path. I now request Dr. Hasnain to come, please come on stage and share his views with our guests.
Assalamu alaikum. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. First of all, our chief guest for the day, Dr. Fakhrul Islam, popularly known as Frank Islam, General Zamiruddin Shah, my colleague with whom I had an opportunity to work together at the Aligarh Muslim University as a member of the Executive Council, Siraj Bhai, for inviting me to be here. I think this is the second or third time I'm here in this wonderful hall. And of course, my colleague at the university, I would like to address him as Professor S.M. Khan. He was, when he retired from the government, when I joined Jamia Hamdard, we have been trying to build Jamia Hamdard. And I'll tell you towards the end of my talk, many of you still perhaps don't know what Jamia Hamdard is, and you think Jamia Hamdard and Jamia Millia are synonymous, or at least think that Jamia Hamdard means it's Jamia Millia. It is not, and that's what it's been possible because of colleagues like Professor Khan who agreed to come to us. As a kid, I used to watch movies, and one of the movies that impressed me much was The Godfather. Mario Puzo, in his characteristic style, says to his adversaries, make him an offer he can't resist. That's exactly what we are doing at Jamia Hamdard, making offers to faculty to come and join us. And today, you'll very soon see how Jamia Hamdard is moving up the ladder without anybody even coming to know about it. Suddenly, we have arrived. Today, as General Sahab rightly pointed out, we are going through a very tough phase in the history of, I would say, of the country. Muslim enrollment, when I was a member of the University Grants Commission, at that time, our enrollment, gross enrollment ratio was only about 12%, which means only 12 kids who graduate from high school could go to the college. The remaining 88% could not find a college. Thanks to the then government, I have served the Prime Minister's Science Advisory Council for 10 long years, and we could convince the Prime Minister of the country at that time that we need to build more educational institutions, we need to build more IITs, more Indian Institute of Science, and more such central universities, and that's where we added our central universities, and today the gross enrollment ratio has gone up to 30, which means 30 students who graduate from high school end up going to 70, end up going to high school, but still a large number, 70 of them, don't get a chance to go to college. So where do they go? The last such statistics that came out, it was mind-boggling. The government of India has, let's say, an X amount of budget for education. 2x amount of budget is spent by citizens of India in sending their kids abroad for education. And who are these people who go abroad? Some are very good, and some are those who could not get a place into an IIT. When I was visiting Stanford University as part of a delegation, the president of Stanford asked us, why are you here? My director was also there. He said, my son studies here, and that's why he's here. He said, but why did you send him to Stanford? You have IIT Delhi, which is a wonderful place. He said, because he could not get into IIT Delhi, so he came to Stanford. This is the reality. I come from IIT Delhi. I'm a professor at IIT Delhi. And when the offer was made to me to join Jamia Hamdard, I thought it was an opportunity for me to do something for the millat, something for the community. And that is why. And I'm very happy that in 2.5 years that I've been at Jamia Hamdard, things have really changed. So we talked about higher education. Look at the primary education which General Sahab rightly mentioned. I'll just give you some numbers, and that will tell you how grave the situation is. In higher education, only 30% today go to college. 70% don't get a seat in the college. This is not my number. This is the number released by the government of India. But in primary education, if you look at it, or let's look at it total education vis-a-vis our Muslim community, just about 4.9 to 5% of Muslims ever go to school. 4.9 to 5%, that's not even 5%. Remaining 95% don't go to school. General Sahib mentioned about they're going to madrasa, and I'll comment on the madrasa education in just a little moment. An average enrollment of Muslims in higher education institutions, if you look at the top institutes, the Muslim minority institutions, which have been created by an act of parliament, Jamia Millia, 50% of the students in Jamia Millia are Muslims. Aligarh Muslim University, 75% of students in AMU are Muslims. In Jamia Hamdard, we have now more than 50% population of students in Jamia Hamdard are Muslims. And the best part is 50% of them are women, which means we are educating the women in our community, and educating the women are more important. And that's the kind of a system that we have here. People, parents feel more secure in sending their kids to Jamia Hamdard than to other places. There was a wonderful survey carried out by Government of India Agency, which has not been published much in the press for obvious reasons, that Muslims are the most backward community in terms of not only economic empowerment, but also in education. Earlier it used to be called that the marginalized community, the so-called scheduled caste and scheduled tribe, were lower than the Muslims in terms of education, but today it's changed. If you look at one community, religious community, it is a Muslim which is the lowest in terms of education. And in fact, if you look at it, the 20 most backward districts in the country, and this is not my number, this is a number coming from Niti Aayog in March 2018, the 20 most backward community in India, backward district in India, about 11 are minority concentration district. Imagine, which means wherever Muslims live, they are by and large, majority of those districts are extremely backward. And what's the status of schools? I'll give one example, just a dipstick example of that. Look at Mewat, not very far from Delhi. Just a few, maybe about 100 kilometer plus from Delhi. Mewat has about 79% Muslim. And you know what distinction it has? It is more than known as India's most backward community, most backward district. This is our district. This is where about 80% of people who live in Mewat are Muslims. And look at the numbers in Mewat, how many actually go? And you'll be shocked. About 162,000 students go to schools. They enroll for primary school. How many pass the 10th class? Forget about 10th class, 8th class. Out of 162,000, just about 30% pass the 8th class. They drop out after 8th class. They don't want to continue further. And those who continue further, just about 8% pass the 10th class. And after 10th class, we have no idea where they go, because there is no local college, if there is, hardly any attendance. So that is the plight of a district that has 80% Muslim population, very next to the capital of India. Who is responsible? We as a community are responsible. We are to be blamed. Why are we not putting education on the top of our agenda? We are putting everything on top of our agenda, but not education. The other day, I went to a butcher shop. I saw the butcher, while he was giving me meat, I saw his son also working. Then I asked him, why are you not sending your son to school? You know what reply he gave? He said nothing to me, he just kept quiet. When I paid him, when I was leaving, he asked me, "Ab bura mat maniyega, how much money do you make?" I said, okay, I make this amount of money. He said, that much he makes in 1 week. Why would you like to study? When you have this kind of mentality in our most of our people, and this mentality has to be broken. I think this is where we are. And if India is trying to emerge as a global power with a large majority of minority which we have, 14% official numbers. Unofficial numbers, people say, are close to 20%. I don't know how far it's true. But official figures are 14% of 1.3 billion are Muslim people by religion, religious minority. If they, this is the condition of the largest minority, how can India become a superpower? I think this has to dawn on the political leadership of the country, unless they have some other kind of agenda. I don't know about that. So that is where we are. You know, I was the Vice Chancellor of Hyderabad University for about 5.5 years. And there, we brought Hyderabad University to the number one university in the country. Then I moved, I was invited to IIT Delhi as a professor by invitation. I wanted to go to IIT. When I wrote the exam, there was mass copying in that center. The entire examination was cancelled. With that, my dream of moving to IIT Delhi was shattered. I got into All India Institute of Medical Sciences, joined there, stayed there for 3 days in the hostel. A person coming from a small town in Bihar, a young boy, could not adjust, left AIIMS and went back to Delhi, went back to Gaya to do my education. And I don't think I regret, because I believe what I am. I have confidence in myself. That is what the Muslim community has to do. They must know what they are. This mad rush to engineering and medical is killing us. There is a room at the top always. You just need to know, do you belong to the top? That is what is required. And that, unfortunately, in our community, we think we are Muslims, so there is a communal angle to it. We will not be allowed to rise in the life. That's why let's not work hard. But nothing is a substitute for hard work. Even today, those who know me from Jamia Hamdard will know that I work for 18 hours per day. Even today, I have my lab at IIT Delhi. 2 days in a week, I am in IIT Delhi. I don't come to Jamia Hamdard. But that's hard work. And that is where I think my message to the community is, we know ourselves better. If my father tells me what to do, I came from a family where my father was a teacher, my mother was a teacher. And they supported me. When I left AIIMS and joined, they said, "Theek hai beta, jo kar rahe ho, acha kar rahe ho. I have confidence in you." I have taken risks after risk in my life, and I don't regret any of the risks. I came to India because when I was visiting India, my father asked me, "What's your plan?" I said, "I'm going back to US day after tomorrow." He said, "No, I want to know what is your long-term plan." And I said, "I will stay there for a few more years." You know what he told me? "Beta, jungle mein mor nacha kisne dekha?" Everybody is not like Frank Islam. I salute him. He has been very successful. We need more of Frank Islam. But we also need people, and I'm proud that I came back to my country. I'm proud that I did not face any discrimination, because this is all in the mind. If you work hard, where is this non-discrimination? Don't we discriminate in our community itself? Don't we have Shia Sunni? Don't we have Barelvi and all this? We have all kinds of nonsense going on. We prefer to wear a religion on our sleeves and then say, "Hamare saqafat mein discrimination hai." Fault lies in us. So friends, we must learn how to live as part of this country. We are a proud citizen of this country. This is a great country, and I'm very proud the country has done so much for us. Just to say that this small wave is going on, this is no reason for us to feel anything otherwise. And I really salute General Sahab for making such wonderful remarks that, you know, we must get into. I can keep on telling, because these days I'm invited more for this kind of lecture. I do give my scientific talks at specialized bodies. But alhamdulillah, I don't think I regret coming here. Let me now spend the last 5 minutes or 7 minutes on Jamia Hamdard to remove the misconceptions about Jamia Hamdard. When I joined Jamia Hamdard, I had been a member of the Executive Council, I was a member of the Academic Council. I knew what Jamia Hamdard was. And when the offer came to me, in fact, our Zameer Sahib was here, he was very keen that I moved to Aligarh Muslim University. In fact, my name figured in the top five initially, but by then I had already joined Jamia Hamdard, and I decided I don't want to be seen as an opportunist. Having joined Jamia Hamdard, I must stay here. And soon I realized that a lot can be done at Jamia Hamdard, and a lot is being done at Jamia Hamdard. Can I have the next book? Okay, I can change the slide myself. How do I change the slide? Okay, Jamia Hamdard was founded by the late Hakim Abdul Hamid Sahib, which you can see on the slide here. And this institution has a very illustrious history. All the top politicians of their time, whether it's Jawaharlal Nehru or Zakir Hussain, and you can see Zakir Hussain here, or even people from outside the country, many of them had come here, including Prince Charles, when he was a prince from England. He was with us at Jamia Hamdard to lay foundation stone. This building is a very historic building. All the 99 mihrabs of the building have the names of Allah painted by the eminent painter of the century, Sadiqain. Allah ke 99 naam humare lage hue hain pure university mein. How can something wrong happen at all to this university? Only good can happen to it, including people like Indira Gandhi and Rahul Gandhi and Rajiv Gandhi came. And the biggest icing on the top was about 8 years ago, we started the medical college. And of course, Jamia Hamdard today is a completely professional university. We have law, and Professor Khan is also the dean of the Faculty of Law. We have 120 seats. And believe me, last year there was a tough competition. The very first year we decided to go for legal studies, 5-year integrated, and the competition was enormous. Every program, we don't conduct our exam at all. We go through national eligibility test, NEET or GRE or whatever. And that is where the quality of students is completely there. So today, if you look at it, where do we stand? We have an institution that has a mission is to provide professional education to large, primarily we are a minority institution, primarily to the minority community. And if you look at where are we in national, international ranking, today we are now ranked among the top 23rd in the country, in the universities in the country. A big jump from 37 what we were a few years ago. And not only top 23rd, our medical college, which is just 8 years old, was last year ranked as the 11th highest ranking medical college in the country. In Delhi, only two medical colleges were ranked that high. Number one was All India Institute of Medical Sciences. And of course, after that, the medical college that was ranked was Jamia Hamdard Medical College. And this is not I have ranked. This is a ranking done by the government of India in today's times. That's very important to understand that. It is similarly, if you look at it, we did an analysis. This is a global top 20 institutions. They have something known as what is known as impact per paper. When I do science, when I do my research, how many people benefit from that science? That is what is known as impact per paper. And top universities in the world, you can, I don't know how many lists can you read, but these are the top universities of the world. They are all somewhere very high in the impact per paper. And how does Jamia Hamdard figure? And I'm very happy to share with you that Jamia Hamdard figures at the top among all universities in the country except Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. Our impact per paper is more than 15. That means at least 15 people, all of our papers are read at least 15 times and quoted. And that is where science is measured. How good is your science? How good is your research? And if you look at the citations, which is also there, we are way ahead of anybody. And if you look at the private universities in the deemed universities, again, we are way ahead of anybody. If the previous slide, you saw the universities in the capital, Delhi. We are marginally ahead of even Delhi University. Among all universities in the country, we are number one, except for Indian Institute of Science, which is ahead of us. And then, if you look at the number of publications, it's increasing every year, large number, and also the citations, enormous citations. And what is the net result of all this? Our students, they have really been able to find jobs in the best places, be it Eli Lilly, be it Cipla, be it Infosys, be it Shell, name the top companies in the world. They all recruit our people. Till last year, this year we don't know. Till last year, TCS used to come. TCS is the world's largest telecommunication software company. They will come to our campus and recruit 30, 40 students in one go. Branding by TCS will make this student's career go touch the moon, literally. And that is the kind of reputation Jamia Hamdard has. The question is, why are we not so well known? And that's the interview I gave. We are a sleeping tiger. We knew who we are, but we never woke up. Now Jamia Hamdard has woken up. And this was a dream as our president of the cultural center mentioned, मैं अकेला निकला था which is true for him, is also true for Hakim Sahib. He started this, unlike Sir Seyed Ahmed Khan Sahib, late Sir Seyed, this was built entirely by vision of one man. When he bought the land in South Delhi, nobody knew that South Delhi will grow. He could have bought in East Delhi, he could have bought in West Delhi or North Delhi. He chose South Delhi, that was his vision. This 100 acre of land we have where the university is, when I joined we had 5,500 students, today 8,000 students. And I hope that in the next 2 years we'll have at least 12,000 students in our campus. And today, let me conclude by saying we are aiming to rewrite the geography of excellence. And the bottom line is, the government of India decided to identify, the Prime Minister thought that why Indian universities are not figuring in the world's top universities. So there was a high-powered committee chaired by a former chief election commissioner, and which had three members from outside the country, mostly US, from Harvard and Ivy League universities. And they looked at all the universities in India, private and public, and tried to rank them as institution of eminence. And they picked up 10 universities in the private sector, 10 universities in the public sector. And the results came out. Jamia Hamdard is the only minority institution in the top 10 in the private sector. We are at number 5. The list has been expanded. In the expanded list, Aligarh also figures. But this is the great pride. An institute which is only 30 years old is now today has become the top 5 among the 500 plus private universities in the country. So those of you who think Jamia Hamdard and Jamia Millia are similar, they are not similar. Jamia Millia is Jamia Millia and Jamia Hamdard is Jamia Hamdard. Thank you for inviting me and thank you for giving me this opportunity.